An anesthesiologist gets a decade behind bars, but what about his victims? Tonight's Inside Story is with one 56-year-old Toronto executive who has gone to extraordinary lengths to share and to own her story of abuse at the hands of Dr. George Dudenaut. Here's Avery Haynes.
Well, thank you, Francis. And up until 10 o'clock this morning, what we're about to tell you, about to show you, would have been illegal. Now, this is the affidavit that had to be signed and presented in court today so that one of Dudenaut's victims could remove herself from a publication ban that still confines the 20 other victims to anonymity.
These pages represent disgusting deeds done by one of this city's most despicable doctors. These are victim impact statements from 21 women, all sexually assaulted while strapped to the operating table, conscious but anesthetized.
Some of the women were having hysterectomies. They were losing their femininity. And all he could do was think, I can get my sexual jollies, yee-haw.
Their names, their faces are shrouded in secrecy, protected by a standard publication ban on sex assault victims.
Some of them, they just can't get over it. They can't sleep. They can't eat. One lady can't sleep with her husband in the same room.
That voice belongs to one of those women. She doesn't want to be part of a secret.
My name's Ellie Brooks. I'm a senior administrator and health and safety officer for an engineering firm.
This man took so much away from you and from 20 other women. Mm-hmm. And part of your wanting to sit here and show your face and say your name is?
This animal did this to us, not to a faceless person, not to a nameless person, but to us.
56-year-old Ellie Brooks was wheeled into the OR for routine surgery in 2010.
The anesthesiologist was Dr. George Dudenaut, and I would like to retract the word doctor because he's not a doctor as far as I'm concerned. He's an animal. A serial sexual predator.
Strapped to the table, a tube in her throat, Ellie says Dudenaut played with the drug dosages to bring her in and out of consciousness.
First thing went through my mind was she's checking the wrong side of my chest for my heart. I thought it was a stethoscope. And as I came out of it more, I realized, time out, it's not a stethoscope. And I got angry. As soon as I was trying to fight back, he put me under again. And I came out of it again, and he was still doing what he was doing. I tried to lift my right hand up to smack him, but my hands were tied down, and he put me out again.
When you came out of this on the table, mm-hmm. were you aware of what he had done?
Oh, yes.
Did you think, okay, I'm filing a complaint against this guy. What he's done is disgusting and a violation of everything that it means to be a doctor.
I thought of it, and I weighed up the odds of who's going to believe me.
And then Ellie was watching the news one evening.
Good evening. They are the people in whom we place our absolute trust. But tonight, a Toronto doctor is accused of breaking that trust in a most horrible way.
And I said, it's gotta be the same guy.
Ellie contacted police and became one of dozens of women to testify at a trial that concluded in November with a guilty verdict on all 21 counts.
Excuse me.
Tell me what it was like to sit in that courtroom and look into the eyes of the man who did this to you and to 20 other women.
Couldn't do it.
You couldn't look into his eyes?
No, the sniveling coward wouldn't look. He had his face down.
Today's sentence does not even come close to what Ellie thinks Dudenaut deserves.
What verdict would have satisfied you?
25 years. No chance of parole for 20. May he rot in the penitentiary. My fondest desire, which is not a nice thought, but I would like to see him sexually assaulted in the penitentiary, lose his power where he can't fight back. That would be justice, total justice.
Sexual assault robs victims of control, power, and dignity. Ellie doesn't want a publication ban to do the same thing.
Because that publication ban that's meant to protect you also, in a way, gives power to Dudenaut.
Oh, absolutely.
Because it keeps you quiet and it keeps you shrouded.
Yeah. I did nothing wrong. I earned the right to hold my head up. And I'm going to take my power back. And he is not going to win. He has not won.
And I think what disturbs me so much about what we saw at the top of our newscast today, mm-hmm. a woman who wanted to stand up and say, I was a victim, I want to show my children what it's like to be a strong, brave woman. And we had to blur her face because she didn't spend the money mm-hmm. or do what Ellie did in order to get her face and name. I think it's a major flaw in our justice system.
Now, Ellie must have a reaction to what Roger also reported today, which was that Dr. Dudnot could seek bail tomorrow, and that means tonight may be the only night he spends in jail.
That's right, and that's one of the things Ellie mentioned, that she can't believe, and she says it's because there's a law for the rich and there's a law for the poor. If somebody was convicted on 21 counts of sexual assault, deemed to be a sexual predator, mm-hmm. this person gets bail. In November, this man gets bail. He hasn't spent any time in jail. Hmm. And so he's spending tonight in jail. His lawyers are going to appeal and then ask for him to be released on bail tomorrow. So he would be spending one night, and Ellie is outraged.
Wow.
Now, Ellie has an awful lot to say, as you can guess by her demeanor in my interview, about her attacker, about the justice system, and what she hopes for other victims of sexual assault. There was so much, in fact, we simply could not put it all in one piece, but you can go to our website for an extended interview with Ellie.